Okay, thank you very much, and congratulations to the organizers with the new center. I will today actually not talk a lot about grid cells. I just put them in introduction, and then I spend the rest of the time on more general aspects of the development of hippocampal circuits, something that I don't really know anything about, but we have sort of bumped into that area. So, but let me just refresh your memories. Grid cells, they look like this. So you saw it already in Hanna's talk, but essentially what this what a grid cell is a cell that fires in particular locations. This is the tracer or rat that has been walking for 30 minutes in a large box. Each dot is one spike, location of one spike, and you can see how they form a hexagonal pattern, which you can also see in this other diagram where I have put red lines on top of it just to help you see the pattern. So these cells, they coexist with other types of cells in the medial entorhinal cortex. You have also head direction cells, you have border cells, and you have speed cells. And they are more or less intermingled with some bias for grid cells to be more in layer 2, but they also exist in deeper layers. And with some bias, at least in rats, for head direction cells to be deeper, and border cells to be all over, but strongly present in layer 2, and speed cells to be all over. So, a question that I want to ask is to what extent does this system of functionally specific cells depend on developmental processes, and to what extent is experience, particular experiences, involved? So one could begin addressing that question by asking when cells with such functional properties appear during development. And in rat, it turns out that many of these cells are actually present as early as it's possible to record them, and that is essentially when the rats start leaving the nest at approximately 2 weeks, 2.5 weeks of age. So let's begin with the place cells. So these are place cells from the CA1 of the hippocampus, recorded from rats that are walking again in square boxes, and color indicates firing rate, and these cells are recorded at different stages of development, so P17 here, 19, 22, and so on, adult at the bottom here. And you can see that spatially specific firing fields are present from the beginning as early as it's possible to get the animals actually to cover a box, which is only a few days after they naturally would start leaving the nest with the mother. The cells are maybe a little bit less stable, but otherwise they have the properties of place cells already. Same goes for border cells. So these show cells that fire along specific borders, local borders of the environment. Adult is what it looks like, and you can see that these cells fire along the east wall in this case, and this is the trace of an animal. And I think you can see that there are more spikes along the east wall than in the rest of the box. But the same is the case at all earlier stages, down to P17, which was the first day when it was possible to get rats to walk out. And there's really no detectable difference in the properties of these cells either. So, and the same goes for head direction cells. So for head direction cells, what you see here is on two consecutive trials. You see the firing rate as a function of the direction of the rat's head. So these are polar plots showing firing rate as a function of direction. And you can see that even at P14, before the rats open their eyes, the cells already have preferential directions of firing. At P14, it's not so stable, and that's not very surprising, because at that age, visual inputs can't be used for correction, so the cells are drifting more, but yet, within maybe 5-10 minutes of recording, the direction of preference is still quite stable. And then after they open their eyes, you can see that on two consecutive trials, the preferences are much more similar. So this suggests that most of these cell types are actually present from very early on. But it's slightly different for the grid cells, because the grid cells, actually are, you can see grid patterns from the beginning down to P16. But as you can see from this plot of examples, the regularity doesn't really appear until the animals reach 4 to 4 to maybe even 5 weeks of age. So before that, from P16 to P28, the cells are quite, they have distinct firing fields and they're more regular than you would expect by chance, but not a lot. So it actually takes 2 weeks of development for the before they reach the degree of periodicity that you see in adult animals. So that raises the question whether could it actually be that experience is necessary for this regularity to develop. And to test that question, we tried to be quite radical in how we raised the animals during the first months of life. So these the animals that participated in this study, which was performed by Ingvild Kruger in our lab, they actually either lived in standard environments, and standard meant quite enriched, they had lots of things to climb on and quite large space. And then they were compared with animals that either grew up for 3 months in cubes or in spheres that were not transparent, but still light could get in. And so the difference between these is only that in the sphere they didn't have any sharp borders, which we would imagine might be useful for animals to actually anchor their firing fields. And then when they were raised in these environments for up to 3 months, then they were exposed for the first time in a square environment, similar to what I showed you before, and we asked them if any grid patterns would appear. And this is the results from the first day of recording. So what you see here at the top, you have examples from animals raised in a sphere, animals raised in a cube, and animals raised in the standard environment. And then the cells are ranked according to periodicity or grid scores that are calculated, essentially show what degree of rotational symmetry the cells have. And what you can see is that in the standard environment, there are lots of cells that have grid patterns, as expected, at when they're tested for the first time in this box. The same is actually more or less true in the cube too. They aren't very different from the ones that are raised in the standard environments. Whereas those that grew up in the spheres, they actually, on the first day, they don't really have any cells that are periodic. There are two cells that pass the statistical criterion, but it's just so, it's not really very convincing. And that can be counted, and what you see is that in the number of grid cells in the sphere group is just above chance. However, if you just test them for a few days more, things change. And what you can see here is recordings from the sixth and from the seventh day after when they were exposed in this box. And you can see that then grid cells start to appear, and that can also be counted. The periodicity can be quantified, and you can see that it increases over days and actually reaches the level that animals had in the other groups at the outset. So that raises the possibility that perhaps this is not really a deficit in the grid pattern, but it's perhaps more related to the fact that they are not used to using outside cues, and it takes some time to learn that. But what it suggests to me is that perhaps this grid pattern is actually quite hardwired, if you want, in the sense that it is, even with quite quite strong deprivation of geometric experience, it is they will still appear after a while. So if that is true, then perhaps it would be useful to know more about the maturation of the circuit during those 4 weeks. What is actually happening? And I've started a longer project on that, but then in the process of working on experiments where we actually want to target developmental populations for later functional studies, then we also asked how does the circuit actually develop itself, and it there's a lot that isn't known yet, so I will just present you some preliminary data on that. And this is the work of Flavio Donato in our lab, who has worked on this previously with Pecco Caroni at FMI in Basel. So how can we measure the maturation of hippocampal and entorhinal principal neurons? So one quite convenient marker is double cortin, which is a protein that is necessary for the growth of dendrites or dendritic branches, and which whose expression goes down at the point when the morphology of neurons reaches a stable state. So this has also been used in as a maturation marker in many previous studies. But so what we did was that we counted cells in each of the areas of the hippocampal circuit and asked how many, what proportion of neurons at different levels and different ages, labeled with nu n, what proportion of those cells expressed also double cortin. So it's a bit difficult to see here because of the light, but I think you figure it out. So you see four cells in the center here, same four cells here, and you see that only one of them expresses double cortin, and you see that again here when they are put on top of each other. So the way we counted this, is all with confocal microscopy. So we then distinguished between the nucleus and between the cytosol, and then counted or measured intensity of double cortin in the nucleus and in the cytosol, and then defined cells where the cytosol had more double cortin than the nucleus, where you wouldn't expect any, as double cortin positive, and the ones where it was less, like in this one, 210 versus 230, as double cortin negative. And then to validate this approach, we then asked what is the percentage of neurons in the adult brain that are double cortin negative, because we would expect that to be that percentage of double cortin negative cells to be very high. So this plot shows the fraction of double cortin positive cells, in other words, immature neurons, for a few of the areas in the hippocampal entorhinal circuit. And you can see that in most areas, MEC layer 2, layer 5, and CA3 and CA1, it's at a noise level, which we would expect. There wouldn't be any immature neurons at the age of P90 to P240. But in the dentate gyrus, the percentage was about 5%, which is in accordance with previous estimates because of adult neurogenesis. So that kind of, to us, validated the method as one approach to measuring number of immature cells. We also used a few other measures, which I won't have time to talk about, but we also measured expression of pyrvalbumin in interneurons, and also counted synaptic or basun puncta, which is a measure of synapses. So then let's go to the data. So what the data showed, first set of data, first we asked what is the fraction of double cortin negative, in other words, mature cells in the different parts of the circuit. So on the x-axis here, you have postnatal day, so from P5 to P30, and the fraction of mature cells on the y-axis, it's a cumulative plot. And then in different colors, you have different stages of the transverse hippocampal circuit. And what you can see is that the fraction of mature cells, or double cortin negative cells, increases first in the medial entorhinal cortex, layer 2, and particularly in the stellate cells. So that goes up and actually reaches adult levels at approximately P17. Whereas the pyramidal cells of layer too in the entorhinal cortex, come a few days later here in light blue, and the same for the CA3 cells. Then come the CA1 cells one step later, again 2-3 days later. Subiculum comes after that, and then comes MSC layer 5, and then comes the lateral entorhinal cortex layer 5, and finally, as the last one, very late, the lateral entorhinal cortex layer 2, which by P30 still hasn't reached 100% maturity. So you can see it's a staggered development, and by and large, this staggering goes through the trisynaptic circuit. There is one exception, the dentate gyrus, which is, where is it? It should be somewhere in the middle, because it's later than CA3. I can't actually find it. Oh, there it is. Okay, so that's the dark green here. But dentate gyrus is very special, so it's maybe not so surprising. But otherwise, the staggering follows the trisynaptic circuit and goes from medial entorhinal cortex to CA3, to CA1, to subiculum, and finally to the deep layers of entorhinal cortex, and then we'll see with the lateral entorhinal cortex lagging further behind. So then we asked, what causes this sequence? Is there any kind of interdependence between the maturation of those levels of the circuit? So in other words, could maturation of, for example, the first one here, the medial entorhinal cortex layer 2, and particularly the stellate cells, could that be necessary for the CA3 to develop? Could it be that the CA3 is necessary for the CA1 to develop, and so on? So to try to approach that question, what we did was that we tried to silence specific subpopulations in this circuit at different stages. And the way to silence was Flavio did was to use an inhibitory dread. That meant that at a very early age, at postnatal day 1, then he injected, using ultrasound to guide he injected into the medial entorhinal cortex or into the hippocampus, he injected a combination of viruses that caused the expression of the inhibitory dread HM4D in the medial entorhinal cortex. And this dread can then be used 2 weeks later when it is expressed widely in the medial entorhinal cortex to silence the neurons. And the way to do it is, of course, to use the ligand CNO, which then specifically targets this HM4D receptor, and then causes the cells to be hyperpolarized or silenced. So he then expressed it, injected a virus at P1, and it was expressed 2 weeks later. And then between P14 and P20, he injected CNO by using an osmotic mini pump that injected at constant rate CNO into the brain or the body of the mouse. So the question then, what happens if you silence cells, for example, in the medial entorhinal cortex? What happens to the rest of the circuit and the MEC itself? And that's the result is shown here. So in this bar diagram up here, you see again the fraction of double cortin negative cells at P20. The silencing was from 14 to 20. And then double cortin negative are the fraction of mature neurons. So if we first look at the black bars, those are from the control animals. And you can see then at postnatal day 20, in accordance with the curve here, you see that in the medial entorhinal cortex, it's almost 100% in the stellate cells here. Pyramidal cells have almost also reached 100%. CA3 has reached almost 100%, and then it goes down. CA1, dentate gyrus, subiculum, medial entorhinal cortex layer 5, lateral, and lateral layer 2. But if you then compare with the red bars, which are the ones that, which are the fractions after silencing for 6 days, the medial entorhinal cortex, you can see that all stages of the circuit, except for the stellate cells in medial entorhinal cortex themselves, are almost at zero here. That means that there's almost not a single mature neuron. You can also see that in the examples below here. So essentially what you see, white is double quoting positive. So the further right you go, the later in the circuit, the more white you can see. And indented, it's still a lot of white because of the adult neurogenesis. But then if you compare control in the upper row and the silence group in the lower row, you see there's a lot more whites in the lower row. So if you then silence at the later stage, if you silence hippocampus instead, so now the injection at P1 was made in the hippocampus, and now you can see that then every stage in the hippocampus and later is silenced. So and what happens then is that no cells go to maturation here, whereas at the earlier stages everything is normal. If you instead silence the lateral entorhinal cortex, only the lateral entorhinal cortex itself is blocked when it comes to development of mature cells. And all of this is at the same stage, namely from P14 to P20. Then what happens within the medial entorhinal cortex? And this result essentially, by and large, not entirely, but by and large, shows what Michel Brecht's group showed earlier this year, I think. Yeah. Not long ago, at least, you scooped us. but the results show both Michel's results and the results from our lab show that there is a development from the dorsal to the ventral medial entorhinal cortex. So what you are supposed to see up here is a little bit difficult to see. But this is the medial entorhinal cortex in a sagittal brain section, and it's just divided into seven different regions, equally large, and they are color-coded here. So the blue one is the most dorsal one, and the brown one is the most ventral one. And then again, same cumulative plots shown specifically for either stellate cells, pyramidal cells, or parvalbumin-positive interneurons. And what you can see is that the maturation is staggered, but this time from dorsal to ventral, so that the dorsal ones are the first one to reach maturity at approximately a little bit before P17, and then at more ventral levels, they don't come up until around P26. And the same happens for the three other types of cells too. And if you compare stellate cells and pyramidal cells, then in the dark blue here, this is at level 1 dorsal, and level 8 is far ventral. And you can see that the dark blue is the stellate cells, and the medium blue is the pyramidal cells in layer 2. And the stellate cells come before at every stage. And in layer 5, then you have pyramidal cells that come several days later. So it's layer 2 that comes first. Then question again, to what extent is this dependent on the stellate cells in layer 2? Or to what extent is it dependent on layer 2? We haven't addressed the type of cell yet. So what we did first was to silence the medial entorhinal cortex, and then again ask what happens to the different types of cells. So if you silence at P14 to P20, the stellate cells themselves, they develop just the same way as they do in controls. So controls are the black ones here, the green ones are medial entorhinal cortex layer 2 silencing. And there's another group too, in orange, is retrohippocampal. That means every area around, just to also take the neighboring regions. And you can see the stellate cells, they don't care. They're not affected by the silencing at all. So after 6 days of silencing, the number of mature cells is still the same. But that's very different for the pyramidal cells, so they're completely blocked. And I could also have shown the interneurons the same thing. But one could say that perhaps P14 to P20 is too late. Maybe it should silence at an earlier stage. So we did that too. So at P11 to P14, which is as early as we were able to go, then again, same thing. The stellate cells still remain unaffected and the pyramidal cells. Now in the controls there are many fewer of them, but you can see that after the silencing they again essentially reach zero. So this seems to point to medial entorhinal cortex layer 2 as an area that is essential for driving the maturation in the rest of the circuit. And the final question we then asked, it's just two slides left, is to what extent could it be the stellate cells that drives this maturation, or to what extent could it be the pyramidal cells? So the way to test that was to exploit the fact that these cells are actually born at different stages during embryonic development. And here we have just plotted the percentage of cells that are stellate cells or pyramidal cells born at different days from E11 to E16. And this is measured in one of two ways, either with BRDU or with a virus, an AAV virus that targets the cells that are born on that day, and gives essentially similar results. But what you can see here is that at E12, it's essentially in the dorsal part of medial entorhinal cortex, essentially only stellate cells, and at E16, at the dorsal part, it's essentially pyramidal cells. So then it was possible to inject this virus with a Cre and in either E12 or E16, and that virus then targeted either stellate cells here or pyramidal cells here. And then at P1, inject another virus that has a Cre-dependent HM4D, so that this inhibitory dread was expressed either in stellate cells or in pyramidal cells. And then at later stages, either P14 to 17 or P23 to 26, or even between, then go with the CNO and see what happens if you silence either the stellate cells or the pyramidal cells. And the result is shown here. So if you silence the stellate cells that were born on E12 within a window plus minus less than a day, then what you see here is that all subsequent stages of the circuit are stopped in terms of maturation or double cortin expression of double cortin negative cells. Whereas if you do the same experiment in the E16 born cells, there's no effect at all. And you might argue that perhaps this approach targets different numbers of cells at E12 and E16, but it's approximately 20+% of the population in both cases. So that suggests that here we have the development of the circuit, or the experiments point to stellate cells as some sort of initiator of this subsequent maturation through the hippocampal circuit, both the transverse circuit and the dorsoventral circuit of the medial entorhinal cortex. What drives the stellate cells? That's still an open question. We also have data suggesting that the maturation along the dorsoventral axis actually follows the neurogenesis of the cells. But exactly what causes this, we don't know, but the stellate cells seem to have a primary role in the maturation of the circuit. And then we see that this takes place over the course of the first, until the fourth week at least, or even fifth week of age, so that it coincides with the development of the slow development of the grid cells, and whether there is any link between it, that still remains to be determined, but it's certainly a possibility. And of course, I didn't do these experiments, but there were many others who did, and they are placed here. They are all listed here, but I should especially mention, where's Flavio? Flavio Donato, who really did a lot of the or most of the development, the maturational work. And Ingvild Kruger, who did the deprivation experiments in the spheres and the cubes. So with that, a lot of people funded it, and I think by that time, by now I should have finished long time ago. Thank you.